Grace and peace, my brothers and sisters. I'm Bishop Charles H. Ellis III, Senior Pastor of Greater Grace Temple of the City of David here in Detroit, Michigan. Happy Good Friday to you. And I am so thankful that you have tuned in to greatergrace.org on this evening. Call everybody you know that has access to the internet. They need to tune in as well because we're getting ready to present our annual illustrated sermon, The Whip, Hammer, and Cross. It's going to bless you. I wish we could do it live on stage. I wish you could be in the City of David, but listen, things are going on now. We can't do that, but the work must continue. Call somebody right now. Tell them to get to their social media platform, whatever they have that is available, to get to the web address, greatergrace.org. We're getting ready to start in just a few minutes. The Whip, Hammer, and Cross, right here from Greater Grace Temple.
Come on, put them hands together and give God some praise up in this house. That sounded like a dead church. If you know that Jesus is alive, put them hands together and make some noise up in here. Everybody, quickly stand to your feet, quickly. Lord, the word that we minister on this evening, get the glory out of all that we do. And out of all that we say, in your name we pray. It is Jesus' name that we pray in. Amen and amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. The Bible tells us in St. John chapter 1 and verse number 1. In the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God. And the Word was God. The Bible goes on to say in verse number 14 that this same word that was in the beginning with God and that was God became flesh and it dwelt among us. We understand that God becoming flesh, being Jesus Christ, born of a virgin. Jesus was not mentioned in the Old Testament scripture by name, but he was always referred to by the various names. Emmanuel, God with us, the Messiah, he that would come to take away the sins of the world. And we know that after the book of Malachi, there were about 400 years of silence in heaven. And then here comes the New Testament, and it comes with the genealogy of Christ and the birthing of Christ and the announcement by the angel that comes and visits Mary, a virgin. We all know the story. We celebrate his birthday during Christmas time here in the United States, December 25th. He's a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, laying in a manger. But at 30 years old, he begins now to be about his ministry. He starts his ministry, selects him some disciples, and he moves now toward that passion and toward the will that God had assigned to his hands. Brothers and sisters, at this point in time, the Jews are in trouble. Israel is being oppressed by the Roman Empire, and they're looking, praying, crying, and wishing for a Savior, a Messiah, somebody that will come and deliver them from Roman rule. The Bible declares in John chapter 3 and verse number 16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." Somebody shout everlasting life. And brothers and sisters, the time that they'd all been waiting for, it is now come. Jesus is coming on a donkey, the foal of an ass, and he is coming through, I doubt, the regions of Bethpage and Bethany, descending from the Mount of Olivet. They begin to spread palms in their coat and their garments in the pathway, and they begin to cry, "Hosanna, blessed is he that comes in the name of the Lord. Welcome the King."
Jesus. Is he worthy? Is he worthy? All right, come on.
Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. And blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Receive thy sight.
I can see. Oh, thank you, Pastor. My son, my beautiful son.
I believe if you touch me, I'll be healed.
Then arise and walk.
can walk. I can walk. I can walk. Thank you, Master. Thank you. I can walk. I don't need this thing anymore. I can walk. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus.
Damsel, I say unto thee, arise.
She's alive! She's alive! My dad! She's alive! Thank you, Jesus! Thank you!
Who is this man?
Time. I mean, people were on high. Hosanna! Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Brothers and sisters, Jesus was in his glory. He was healing all manner of diseases. That woman who had had that issue of blood for all of those years, just one word from the master, and the fountain immediate, tell the neighbor, he's an immediate God. That woman who had never seen her son. What a blessing. What a miracle. What a glorious time in her life to be able to see her son for the very first time. That boy never able to walk, lame from his mother's womb. But one touch from Jesus, when he says, do it, you better do it. Rise, take up your bed, and get to walking up in here. And the best of all, that young daughter, Bible calls her a damsel, dead. But Jesus takes things that are dead and brings them back to life. Tell that neighbor, what a man. Brothers and sisters, with all of that was going on and the great time, that's not really why he came. He didn't just come to heal, but he came for a far greater purpose, to reconcile a sinful man back to a holy God. All of those prophets of old, from Moses all the way to Malachi, Daniel, Ezekiel, Jeremiah, Isaiah, those in the middle, major prophets, minor prophets, Elijah, Elisha, all of them were great men of God, but they were not sinless, and they could not serve as the perfect sacrifice. Jesus had to come, God wrapped in flesh, to deliver man back into fellowship and communion with God. The Bible declares that Jesus tells his disciples to go in to prepare a room that they would have supper. And we know it as the Last Supper. During this Last Supper, Judas is informed by the Lord, or challenged by the Lord, to whatever you're going to do, go ahead and do it. Get it over with and do it quickly. Judas had already prepared to conspire with the chief priests, Caiaphas, and the hierarchy of the Jews to betray Jesus. And brothers and sisters, isn't that just like people? They will sing your praises one day and flip on you just like that. And perhaps I need to give some of you a word. Some of you supposed to be at the club tonight partying with your friends, but you told them, I'm going to church. You're going to church. You're trying to do something better to better your life. Watch those friends. They're probably right now conspiring against you. But tell that neighbor, God's got my back. The Bible says that after they have supped, that Jesus leads them out into a garden called Gethsemane. And he takes his disciples out a ways and he tells them to watch. And I'm going yonder to pray. And I can imagine in my mind that he kneels over a stone, a big rock like this, contemplating the great death that he must die. The Bible says that there was so much anguish in his emotions that sweat ran down his brow like great drops of blood. He knows the price that must be paid and is setting in the soberness that the miracles are done. Now it's time to pay that awful price. And I can hear him in that garden as he cries out, Father!
Oh, my Father! If it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. Peter, could you not watch and pray? Pray that you enter not into temptation. The spirit is indeed willing, but thy flesh is weak. Oh, my Father, if this cup shall not pass from me except I drink of it,
thy will be done.
Where?
Go on now.
Is he?
And take your rest.
Find him!
Behold, the hour is at hand when the Son of Man shall be betrayed into the hands of sinners. Arise! 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 Let us be going. The Son of Man with a kiss? Whom seek ye?
We seek Jesus of Nazareth.
I am he.
Push me, idiots! How dare you touch the high priest?
Whom seek ye?
We seek Jesus of Nazareth.
Again, I say that I am he. If it is I that you seek, then let these go their way, that the saying might be fulfilled which was said, unto them that thou gavest me have I lost none.
What? Malchus, seize him!
My ear! He cut my ear!
Peter, put thy sword back into thy sheath. The cup that my father has given me, am I not to drink of it?
What is he doing?
My ear. He healed my ear. He is the Messiah. He is the Messiah.
Away from me, you fool. You were never cut. Guards, seize him and seize him now. We got him.
So they arrested Peter, Jesus, and they took him from the garden and took him to the high priest Caiaphas. Caiaphas was not a friend of Jesus. He was actually an enemy of Jesus. Caiaphas gotten jealous because all the attention had been transitioned from him and the Sanhedrin to John the Baptist, and now this man from Nazareth called Jesus the Christ. They wanted to do away with him. From day one, they wanted to get rid of him. Now, the Jewish custom and laws only allowed for them to stone him, but they had a far greater death that they had planned for Jesus. They wanted him to be crucified. And their laws and their customs would not allow for that. They would have to turn him over to the Romans. So they started trumping up charges that he is hailing himself as a king. Caesar, he's not a threat to us, but he's a threat to Caesar. And they turned him over to Pilate. Pilate thought the matter was frivolous. Why don't you all handle it? You all have laws, you have customs. Deal with it in your own courts. But they really wanted to crucify Jesus. Pilate thought he could get rid of it when he found out that he was from Nazareth. He's a Galilean. Well, Herod's in town. Send him over to Herod. Let him deal with this. I don't have time for this. They send Jesus over to Herod. And Herod was not pleased with him. Herod felt that it was not worth his time to even hear the case. So they bounced Jesus back to Pilate's judgment hall. The Bible says that Pilate's wife had been warned in a dream not to have anything to do with this man called Jesus. But Pilate was a man pleaser, a people pleaser, and he did not care for the things of God. Brothers and sisters, there are some of you in here today that care more about what people think than about what God thinks. People don't have a heaven or a hell to put you in. And sometimes we want to be liked by people, that we do things just so that people will like us. I pray that all of us get to a place where we could care less what anybody thinks about us. All that matters is what the Lord thinks about me. And I'd rather have everybody walk away and forsake me than to know that God still got my back. Did they have thousands trying to hang with me, and the Lord is not pleased. They bounced Jesus from the high priest to Pilate, from the Pilate to Herod, from Herod back to Pilate. And now he stands before Pilate's judgment hall. Pilate can't get rid of the case. He's got to hear the case. He's got to address it. And I hear, what's that noise? It sounds like a crowd. Sounds like a crowd, but it doesn't sound like the same crowd just the other day that was crying Hosanna. I told you, people can flip on you. Now there's a different cry. It sounds like crucify him. Let me tell you something. People will smile in your face and all the time won't take your place. What the OJs call them folk? Backstabbers. Lord, don't let me fall into the hands of an angry crowd
and a violent mob.
We are going to crucify him. He is no king of all. He's nothing but a blasphemer. He's no king. He's nothing but a blasphemer. And we're going to stop this if it's the last thing that we're going to do. He's nothing but a blasphemer. Blasphemer, I say. He's nothing but a blasphemer. And we're going to stop this. Is he your king? He's no king of mine. Is he your king? What line of king does he descend to? Because he doesn't descend to me, he's no king of mine. He's nothing but a blasphemer. And we're gonna stop this. Nothing but trickery, sorcery. And we're gonna stop this nonsense. Nothing but a blasphemer. Crucify him. We are going to stretch him high, and we're going to stretch him wide. We are going to nail him to the cross. Crucify him. Crucify him. Crucify him. Crucify him. Crucify him. Is he your king? Well, he's no king of mine. Is he your king? We are going to crucify him. Crucify him. Crucify him.
And what meaneth this? And why are you here?
This man says he's the Messiah. That violates the Roman traditions and comes against the Jewish law. And you are the governor, Pilate. We want him judged. Judge him. Judge him. Judge him. Judge him.
Bring Jesus here to me.
Look at him. He's worthless.
And you call this man a blasphemer? And what has this man done?
Look at him! He says he's the king of the Jews! Judge him, Pilate! Judge him! Judge him!
Judge! Have you lost your mind, Caiaphas? I am the governor here. You watch your manner of tone with me, or I will have your tongue cut out. Now, you have taken this man from judgment hall to judgment hall and to the elders, and all council has judged him. And I find no fault in this man.
What?
Are you king of the Jews?
It is as you say.
Are you king of the Jews?
It is as you say.
And where are you from? Are you not answering me? Do you know that I have the power to crucify you and the power to release you?
You would have no power at all against me, except it be given to you from above. Therefore, he who hath delivered me to you has the greatest sin.
You have a custom that I release someone to you at the Passover. Do you therefore that I release unto you your king of the Jews? Or Barabbas, who is a known murderer?
We have no king but Caesar. He is no king of ours. He's nothing but a blasphemer. Give us Barabbas and crucify this man. Crucify him. Crucify him. We got him. We want him dead. We're gonna crucify him. We got him.
Barabbas, give us Barabbas. Barabbas, Barabbas.
That's what we want.
Give us Barabbas.
Behold the man, for I find no fault in him. You take him, and you do as thy will. Guards, release Barabbas.
You fools! You should have never let me go!
and take this man away. I wash my hands of this man's blood.
And let his blood be on our hands. And on our children's hands, we're going to crucify him. Crucify him. We got him. Crucify him.
So they took Jesus and they rushed him off to the scourging hall. It was at this place that they unmercifully beat and tortured criminals. They had several ways of torturing them, several methods and things that they would do. When they would whip criminals, they had all kinds of ways and methodologies. All kinds of whips. Those of you that are 45 and up, you all know that when mom and daddy used to whip you, grandmama or big mama, they had all different kinds of methodologies. Sometimes they would just hold you by one hand. Sometimes they would sit in the chair and put your head in between their legs and knees. And you know, the other part was sticking out and they would just. Sometimes they whip you with clothes on, and then sometimes I paid too much for them clothes. Get all of them off. They used all kinds of whipping apparatuses. They had black leather strap belts. They had ironing cords. They had razor straps. I remember one boy in school used to get whippings with garden hose. Used to come with big whips on his legs. Most everybody know about the switch. And those switches, you never ran out of switch. As long as you had a tree, you had a switch. And likewise in Rome, they had all different kinds of whips. One in particular that was most famous was called the Cat of Nine Tails. And the Cat of Nine Tails was the kind of whip you use when you absolutely just wanted to inflict great bodily harm and literally beat a prisoner into inches of his life. It had nine extensions that protruded from it. And thus they called it the Cat of Nine Tails. They also put various fragments and intermingled them in between those extensions. Iron and lead and sharp metals, glass. And when they would whip a prisoner with this kind of whip, those fragments would lodge into the skin of the prisoners. When they would yank it back, it would literally tear and rip their flesh open. That's how they whipped Jesus. They whipped him in that intercourse. But the Bible says he never said a mumbling word. Can you believe it? Took a whipping like that and never said anything. But it wasn't enough just to whip him privately. They wanted to whip him publicly. And I can see them as they bring him out into the outer court. And they want to whip him before an audience. I can see them as they begin to tie him to that whipping post. The captain of the guard saying, "You mean to tell me you fellas put a whip on him and he didn't even say nothing? Didn't beg you, didn't cry for mercy, didn't holler, didn't shed a tear?" He said, "Let me put a whip on his back and show you how to do it. I'll make him beg for his life." Brothers and sisters, what they didn't understand was that that whipping that he took, it wasn't just a natural whipping. It had great spiritual significance. For the word of God says, "Who shall believe our report? And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? He shall grow up as a tender plant out of a dry ground. He had no form or comeliness. And when we see him, we won't even desire him. He was stricken, smitten of God, led to the sheep like a slaughter. But thank God it didn't end there." Isaiah said, "But let me tell you the real purpose of a whipping." He said, when he was whipped, he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes, we are healed. Every time they struck him, somebody got healing. Every time they beat him, somebody got deliverance. Every time they whipped him, somebody got healed. I can see that other guard. "Let me have a piece of it. Let me show you fellas how to do it." And even as he began to crack that whip on the back of Jesus, every time he got struck, somebody was getting delivered. So whip on, because somebody's getting healed. Tonight somebody's getting delivered. Tonight somebody's being set free. I can see one of the guards go over to a thorn bush. They heard that he called himself the King of the Jews. Every king deserves a crown. And I can see them as he begins to form and to make a crown out of thorns. Historians tell us that there were 72 thorns that was in that crown. And when he took that crown back over to the head of Jesus, and I can see him as he presses that crown down on the brow of Jesus. Everywhere a thorn pressed into his brow, blood came streaming down. Blood came gushing out. They marred him. They had beat him unrecognizable. Eyes swollen, face swollen, webs all over his body. Then somebody said, "Who's gonna carry his cross?" "I'm not gonna carry his cross." Many years later, the songwriter penned the words, that old hymn of the church that we love to hear. "Must Jesus bear the cross alone and all the world go free?" Somebody tell a neighbor, "No, no, 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 no. There's a cross for everyone. There's a cross for you. And there is a cross even for me." They took Jesus down to that cross. And it was Josephus that said, The greatest pain that Jesus felt was not that whipping. It was not even that crown of 72 thorns that they placed upon his head. But it was that old rugged cross with those wood splinters that pressed into his shoulder blade and bone. They paraded him through the streets and opened naked shame. See how they did our Lord and our Savior. See how they did our Lord and our Savior. Many prisoners and malefactors, they were tied to the cross. But this one, they purposed to nail him to that cross. Brothers and sisters, even utilizing the word nail probably is not significant enough as to what they really used. We're not talking about nails that you buy at a hardware store. We're talking about big, thick railroad truck spikes. They would drive these through the hands and through the feet of prisoners and those sentenced to death. I can see them as they take Jesus over to that cross, as they get ready to nail him to that old rugged cross. I can see them take his precious hand, that hand that made a spittle of clay, anointed a blind man's eyes and told him to go wash in the pool of Siloam, and he came back seeing. Those hands that broke fish and loaves and fed multitudes. Those hands that were laid on the sick and the depressed. And they were healed and those demons were cast out. He placed the nail in that hand of Jesus. And I can see him as he lifts that hammer to the sky. And he came down. And again. And again, gave that hammer to another guard. He did likewise, put a spike in the other hand of Jesus. And I can see him too raise that hammer to the sky. And he came down, and again, and again. See the captain of the guards. Give me that mallet. Give me that hammer. I don't need two spikes. Give me one. I'll put his feet on top of each other. And I'll drive a spike through with such force, he ain't coming down off this cross. And he took those precious feet of Jesus that walked on water, that walked throughout the Galilean shore, through the backside of the Arabian desert, that went from village and city and town, spreading the gospel and the good news. He raised that hammer to the sky and came down, and again, and again. See how they did, our Lord? Spat on him, gave him mock worship. They had punched him, kicked him, beat him unmercifully. But then somebody got smart. They said, I'm tired of fooling with this. Get him up. But I think that's where they messed up. They probably should have left him on the ground. I ain't saying, but just maybe they would have got some victory. But when they lifted him up, Jesus had already said, if I be lifted up above the earth, I'll draw men unto me. Somebody ought to lift up Jesus. Somebody ought to lift up the Savior. Tell that neighbor, lift him up. They marched Jesus over to Golgotha, the hill, the place of the skull. They had already dug out a deep hole to drop the cross in. when they got him up on that mountain and up on that hill called Calvary. I can imagine that when they dropped that cross in the ground, his flesh ripped and tore.
What does the cross of Jesus mean? It's more than words we sing. Much more than that emblem on your chain. Oh, it means I'm free from the chains of slavery. Blood he shed won't let my sins remain. Oh my, upon the cross my Savior died. The Lamb was crucified, showed us love that this world had never known. Love God has for me. When the Lord of glory had been sent, gave all on Calvary just for me, just for me.
Hour. had every reason to want to curse everybody, had every reason to want revenge and his vengeance. But to the contrary, he said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Doesn't matter how people treat you. What matters is how you treat people. There were two criminals that were crucified with him, one on each side, and one had the audacity, as if he had done nothing wrong. If you be the Christ, why don't you come down from the cross, and while you're at it, save us too, bring us down. The other criminal said, are you kidding? We deserve to be here. But this man has done nothing. He saw something in Jesus. And he asked Jesus something strange, because Jesus was dying like him. But he caught a revelation. He caught a glimpse of who Jesus really is. And he said, Lord, when you come into your kingdom, I believe you got a kingdom. And when you get there, please remember me. And Jesus stopped dying long enough to say, today, not tomorrow, but today shall thou be with me in paradise. It ain't never too late to ask God for some help. Don't you let nobody tell you you can't be helped. Tell that neighbor, the devil is a liar. There's help for you. There's help for me. Feeling the weight of the world and the sins of the entire world upon his shoulders. That price that must be paid, the time is now. God cannot look upon sin, and God turns his face. And Jesus, feeling that cold and abandonment, he cries out, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani? My God, why hast thou forsaken me? Anybody out there ever felt forsaken? Y'all ain't saying that. Anybody out there ever felt all by yourself? Have you ever felt like you ain't had nobody on your side? Jesus knows how you feel. Then he said something strange. Two words. I thirst. One of the soldiers heard him, and he went and found a stick with a sponge, a reed on it, and he dipped it in vinegar and put it up to the mouth of Jesus. You thirsty? I don't have water, but here. He didn't even understand that Jesus was not speaking naturally. I mean, if he wanted natural water, he walked on water. I mean, he had control of water when he wanted water. I mean, he was able to calm the winds and the waves. In the beginning, God said, let the waters come, and they came. If he wanted water, he could have called water, but he was thirsting for some souls. He wasn't on that cross dehydrated of water. He was on that cross wanting to replenish himself with souls of the kingdom. And somebody tonight ought to be saying, Lord, you're thirsting for me. I'll quench your thirst tonight. Yes, I will. Knowing that all things had been accomplished and the price had been paid, he cried out, it is finished. And after he cried out with that loud voice, the Bible says that he looks to heaven and he says, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. And he hung his head and he died. But at that time, the earth got dark and began to reel. And when the earthquake subsided, this is what they saw. Jesus, having given up the ghost, dead, no life, on the cross of Calvary. Nobody's laughing now. Nobody's playing. Because we've never heard that kind of thunder. Never seen that kind of lightning before. After all, it is daytime, but look at how dark it is. Never felt the earth rumble and move like that. As they begin to gather themselves, I see the captain of the guard, the soldier. He's looking around for his band, and they've all run off. They've scurried out. Nobody's playing now. Nobody feels any pride now. And before he knows it, he knows he's never experienced an earthquake like this. He's never seen this kind of eclipse where it's pitch black at 12 noon. And before he knows it, he cries out, "Surely, surely he must be the Son of God. What have we done? Surely he's got to be the Son of God. Look at what we've done. We've crucified the Son of God."
I will sing your praise, for you've done such a marvelous thing for someone so wretched. Yet my soul you have redeemed. Thought my soul was worth it. So you gave your only battle already. you delivered me.
Marvelous.
It was marvelous.
So marvelous.
And then you changed me.
It's marvelous.
You rearranged me.
Marvelous.
You set me free.
Marvelous.
Free from my sins,
so Lord. Marvelous.
I want to thank you, Lord.
It's marvelous.
For what you've done for me.
Marvelous.
I want to thank you, Lord.
Marvelous.
For setting me free.
So marvelous.
You even broke the chain.
Marvelous.
That held me bound.
Tell that neighbor is marvelous. Tell that neighbor is marvelous. But that's not how the story ended. I said, that's not how the story ended. Tell that neighbor, wait, there's more. Everybody be seated. There's more. It is marvelous. It was marvelous. They wanted to hasten the death of those prisoners and Jesus because it was the time of the Passover. And there was no work or anything to be done during Passover. It was almost sundown. So they went to the cross, and the Bible says that they broke the legs of the two thieves that was crucified with Jesus. And that was something in a measure that they took that would hasten the person's death. And when they got to Jesus, they found that he was already dead, because the prophet had already prophesied that not a bone of his body would be broken. So there was no need to break the legs of Jesus. So they begged of Pilate to release the body of Jesus, to take him down off the cross. They didn't have a lot of time to prepare the bodies like they normally would, to wash and to clean and to put the various ointment and spices on. Back in that day, they certainly didn't embalm, but they did wash those bodies, and they would prepare them with ointments and spices, perfume, and then wrap them. They didn't have time to do all of that because, again, they couldn't perform these tasks during the Passover. So they hurried Jesus off the cross, and they put him in the tomb of one by the name of Joseph of Arimathea. And they had purposed to come back days later after the Passover and to properly prepare the body of Jesus for burial. A strange thing happened, though. Caiaphas and some of those in the Sanhedrin, they went to Pilate and made the strangest of requests. They wanted Pilate to secure the tomb with armed soldiers. Who ever heard of guarding a dead man's tomb? The dead can't hurt you. They certainly are not alive. They're not going anywhere. But they made this special request of Pilate. Pilate thought it was very strange. Thought absolutely that it made no sense at all. Why would I assign my precious resources to my centurion soldiers to stand guard and watch at a dead man's tomb? It seems as though you all won't quit. You won't give up. You want the Barabbas? I gave you Barabbas. You wanted Jesus crucified? You've crucified him. Now he's in the grave. He's dead. And you want me to assign armed guards at his tomb? Sounded like a strange request. I can imagine Pilate thinking to himself, these people won't give up. These folk won't quit. He's thinking now about his reputation. He's already judged a man that he knew was innocent, because he said, I find no fault in him. I tried to get out of it by comparing Jesus of Nazareth to a madman, a killer, Barabbas. Oh, for sure that would get me out of it. These people asked for Barabbas. And brothers and sisters, you have to be careful what you ask for, because you just might get it. And when you look at our society today, we got Barabbas running all over our neighborhoods. We've got Barabbas in our schools. We've got Barabbas in our homes. Barabbas all over our society. Pilate said, couldn't get out of it that way. I gave him to you all to crucify. You crucified him and you put him to death. But now it still seems as though you won't quit. You're asking for more. So they wanted armed guards. Just do us this, Pilate. Just give me one good reason Do you believe that he will rise from the dead? Well, he said that he would in 3 days, but we don't believe that. But we believe that his disciples are so zealous and fanatical that they'll steal his body and then perpetrate a lie that he is alive and he really rose from the dead. Pilate, we beg of you, just do us this one thing. Pilate assigned guards at the tomb. I can see the guards coming, standing watch at the tomb of Jesus, wondering in their minds, why are we here? What is the purpose? And you know, when I think about the devil in hell, they were probably partying because they thought that it was over. They thought that they had gotten rid of Jesus. And the first night passed, and the first morning came, and everything was quiet, serene at the tomb of Jesus. And the second night passed, and the second morning came. Everything was still a hush and very quiet. And then the third night passed, but just before the breaking of the third morning, there was a rumbling and a tumbling at the tomb of Jesus. The earth shook and the ground rocked and the soldiers fell as dead men and scurried out. And just when the devil thought he had gotten the victory, early on the third day morning, God dispatched an angel. And just like God has an angel for Jesus, he's got an angel for you. He's got an angel for me. And the Bible says that the angel of the Lord, he went over to the tomb of Jesus and he began to roll that big stone away from the tomb. And early on the third day morning, out came Jesus from the tomb. No man take my life. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it up again. Oh, death, where is thy sting? Oh, grave, where is thy victory? Somebody celebrate the risen Savior. Celebrate Jesus!
Oh,
been blessed by us sharing the whip, hammer, and cross through this streaming mechanism on this evening. I pray, my brothers and sisters, that you were blessed by it. I pray that you were encouraged and inspired. Maybe it gave you that spiritual adrenaline shot that you needed. Maybe it gave you that pick-me-upper that helped you to focus a little bit more on things that are really important and really to bring your mind in on what Christ did for you and for me. I certainly pray that it blessed you as well as your family and everybody that you shared it with. And I encourage you that if it did, and if you can, sow a seed into the ministry. We could use your help, especially during this time of crisis. The information is right there on your screen. You can make your checks or money orders payable to Greater Grace Temple, mail them to the address that is on the screen, or you can stay right on this web address. Go to our Givelify app and you can give electronically right through that mean. Thank you for tuning in on this evening. Again, I pray that you have been encouraged, inspired, and blessed, and know that we love you to life right here from